Having discussed about the various accounting functions, we would now be discussing about the financial management, which are the major decisions that need to be taken by a financial manager. And to discuss with you on this topic, we have with us Professor Ravi Shankar, who will be discussing with you on financial management.
Yeah, welcome back. As I have told you in the beginning itself, there is a very specific purpose for selecting these two topics for today, because we may not be able to talk to you on this particular course again. So what we thought is we should give you a very crux of the small overview of the entire course. So in the first session, we try to tell you the accounting part. Just see what is happening.
One more important point is taking up that topic on accounting and functions is that it may help you in solving the problems which are there in accounting.
Yeah. What is happening is, whatever we have spoken in the last session is related to the first three blocks of your material. The course, as you are aware, the course is divided into five blocks, and first three blocks are relating to the accounting part, and later two blocks are relating to the finance part. So what we tried to cover in the last session was a brief sketch of the first three blocks. Just see the slide. The first block, talks about accounting and its function, accounting concepts and standards, accounting information and its application. This is the first block. Second block, we talk about the balance sheet, which is the final summarization function, what we are talking, summarization function. So whatever you have prepared, data recorded and classified will be reflected in the form of profit and loss account and balance sheet. So in the second block, we try to talk to you about the profit and loss account, balance sheet, and then the cash and funds flow statements, because these are the statements which gives information about the company to the users of the information. Then the third block, the third block talks about the cost management. The importance of cost management we need not again emphasize with you, because cost management is a very important thing in the present day competitive world. So in that sense, we try to cover the first three blocks in the first session. Now what I will be doing is covering of the second, the later two blocks, that is block 4 and 5. So there is a definite and specific purpose for selecting these two units. So I would like to impress upon you, if you are slightly more careful about these two blocks, these two units, you should be able to do better in this particular course. So financial management, coming to the specifics of this particular session, financial management, we try to give you an overview of the financial management in this particular session. So what are the activities we undertake in the business activities? Includes production. First you produce the things, then you sell them in the market or distributors, whatever it is, then you get money. So the role of finance comes there. That is one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it is, even before starting the production, even before undertaking any particular business activity, you need money. So in a way, that comes in the first. Finance comes first there. So when we discuss these details, we will be able to understand these concepts better. So these three are very critical in the business activity. Okay, human resources, I don't say it is less important, because it is ultimately the human being which makes or marks the things. So that is also important, but primarily production And once you produce, you have to sell, and once you sell, you have to use that money for in a better manner, so that it will further lead to further profits. So this is the thing. So the finance function, as we say, is basically divided into three major decisions. If you say financial management, it is simply it is three decisions, though it is not very so simple, but if you are talking about three decisions or three sections of the decisions, the all decisions in the financial management can be broadly classified under investment decisions, financing decisions and dividend decisions. Because investment decision is a important decision in the sense, the money you have raised through various sources, as a promoter you must have brought some money, or you must have raised through your friends or through your banker or whatever may be the source. The money you have raised, if you don't put them into a proper use, that is, if you don't invest them into a proper manner, in the proper assets, in the proper combination, what happens is the whole money will go waste. So ultimately you will be left with only debts and no money. So it is a very crucial decision. Then financing decision, because basically what we do is two types of sources we have for financing a particular asset. Either own capital, that is called in the corporate context it is called equity capital, and the borrowed capital or debt capital. So these are the two particular sources of capital. So if you, and there are situations where to use the equity capital and where to use debt capital, or if at all you are using a combination of both debt and equity, what should be the combination of debt, what should be the component of debt, and what should be the component of the equity. Because this, it is very critical. Suppose if you are able to earn a particular level of return more than what is your cost of capital, so then it is better you use debt, and still you are saving something. If your cost of equity is more than your cost of debt, so naturally we will like to use cost of debt and create more profits for the existing shareholders. So that is why fixing this combination, the proportion of each debt and equity is also very important. The third one is dividend decisions. Dividend, whatever profit you are generating, sometimes what the companies does is, what companies do is, they keep some of the profits generated as in the form of retained earnings, and distribute the remaining part as the dividend. This also depends on the situation of the company, where how much profitable plans they have for the future, and at what cost the debt is, what cost the finance is available in the market. Putting these two factors into consideration, then they will decide whether to keep the money with them or give the entire profit in the form of dividends. So these are very critical. Though they appear to be very small kind of things, they are very critical. The whole profit and loss of the company depends on these three decisions. Because if you are able to generate more rate of return than your shareholders, if they are not able to generate a level of return which you are able to pay them by investing the profits in the business again, then it is better to retain the profits and give them a better rate of return, so that they get more profits and at a higher rate. So each of these decisions must match with the objectives of the firm. This is again important, because If the objective of the firm is to generate more profit, if these things are not in that tune, if you are not planning these decisions in that objective, then the objective cannot be achieved, because whatever decisions we are taking, all those financial decisions fall in these three categories. So the objective of the firm has to be matching with these decisions have to be matching with the objectives of the firm. So once you combine these decisions in a more judicious way and carefully, they will maximize the value of the shareholders. Because, as I told you, dividends decision is a very important decision for them, because if they are not able to, whatever dividends you are paying, if they are not able to invest those money in a better manner, so your dividends have gone waste. And if you are able to keep them, the profits with you, and able to give better returns, then it is their value of the value of the shareholders is definitely higher. Similarly, financing. If you choose a wrong combination of financing sources, ultimately it is going to reduce your profitability. Similarly, if you invest them in the investment decision part, if you invest them in idle assets which are not going to give you any return, they are also going to affect your profitability. So now let us come to one by one each three one of these one by one these three decisions. We call investment decision is the most important decision among the three, because it relates to the assets in which the funds are invested. Because assets, definitely, you, as you are aware, some of the assets are very have a long term life, and some of the assets have short term life. What we call them is capital assets and current assets. What are the current assets? We normally see in the corporate world, inventory, receivables and cash, like that. These are used within a period of 1 year. So a particular level of investment is required in these assets. And long term assets, for example, if you are purchasing a plant and machinery or a building, then the decisions are very important, because if these decisions are going to be of relevance for years and years together. Because a building purchased or even built for a particular purpose has its impact for several years on the company, because you cannot just sell them or just wind up that particular asset. Like suppose if you have invested in a particular share or invested in a deposit, a particular bond, still you can, maybe if you feel that is a wrong decision, then you can sell those shares or bonds and get back your money, maybe at a profit or even at a loss. But if you have invested the money in a particular plant or even in a building, you cannot take back the decision so easily. What happens is, suppose if you are buying a particular, if you are constructing a building, say for example, so the important decision there is whether to invest so much of money in buying, in purchasing a land and constructing a building and then occupying it, whether that is wise, or take a building which is already there on a rental basis and run your operations for a on a long term agreement. So you have to see which of the situation is more profitable to the company. Because if you are constructing a big building, it costs you a lot of money. And if you have lot of money, idle money, then it is a different story. But if you are borrowing at a higher rate, and the interest you are paying for that particular amount is higher than your rent, I don't see any reason for a particular company to go for a construction. Rather, you go for a rental building, which may be costing you at a lower rate, and which ultimately is going to yield a better return to the company. Similarly, plant and machinery. What happens there? The question comes whether to hire or purchase. If a company is going to give you on a particular plant and machinery on a higher basis, higher purchase basis, well, there is no need for you to buy, because if the higher we are paying or higher rentals we are paying is less than your interest you are paying for that particular capital, it is not wise enough to buy such machine and incur more cost to the company. So what happens is, these two things are very important, particularly in the long-term context. So these two decisions are very important, because ultimately they are going to affect your profitability. Then what happens? Then what is the situation? Long-term, if you want to acquire long-term decisions, you need a particular type of decisions required, and maybe some techniques you would like to use for coming to those decisions. What we call them as capital budgeting techniques. Capital budgeting techniques. These relate to the long-term capital of the long-term assets, acquisition of long-term assets. Similarly, for short-term assets acquisition, you have liquidity decisions, because if you don't keep lot of sufficient money in the for paying your debtors, what happens is that creates a bad image for the company, and ultimately the reputation of the company is spoiled. So you have to have sufficient cash balances in order to meet your debt obligations. Maybe trade debtors only, because normally when we say liquidity point of view, we talk about short-term liquidity, and of course long-term liquidity is also important. When you have a particular debt instrument is coming to a maturity, that time you need long-term liquidity also. So what I am trying to say is, capital budgeting and liquidity decisions are very important, which are covered in these two blocks in detail. What is capital decision? Capital budgeting decision. Capital budgeting, there are some 4 or 5 techniques are there. You can go through that particular unit, you will be able to understand very clearly. And the purpose of this particular technique is choosing the right project. When you have different kinds of projects, which project is going to give you? Because they will have, definitely they will have different cost of raising the funds. So, and they will also have different cost of different rates of return. So you have to analyze their costs and return and come to the best solution, which will give you the maximum return to the company. Sometimes what happens is, things may not be very simple. There may be many uncertainties and risks which are related with these capital budgeting decisions. So if you have to come to a correct decision, you have to take those risks and uncertainties also into consideration. Then only things will be more realistic. So what happens is, in the capital budgeting process, what we do is, we compare our cost of returns with the cost of capital, and whichever project gives you the higher return, that project will be selected and other projects will be kept pending. Because if you have lot of money, then it is a different matter. Whatever project you are taking up, and if that project is giving you more return than your cost of capital, you can undertake all those projects. But issue is, money, capital is not so abundantly available for everybody. So you have to rationalize and prioritize rank your projects. So depending upon the ranking, you will select which project to be taken first and then what is the next, then what happens for the remaining project. As and when you feel comfortable, you may go for the remaining projects. But the purpose of this technique is to come to the best possible project which gives you the maximum return. You want to say something?
Yes.
Yeah. Then the liquidity ratio. As I told you, current assets, inventory, accounts receivables, cash and marketable securities. And then these are current assets. Of course, current liabilities
can be converted into within a short period.
Okay. These, what we say is,
convertible into cash.
These assets are assets which can be converted within a period of 1 year into another form. Because I don't say it is only cash, because these assets keep changing their form very quickly, and within a period sometimes it keeps changing. Suppose if you have cash, then you buy inventory. Then inventory, if you have inventory, once you sell the inventory, you get the cash.
So it can be converted into marketable securities.
Yeah. So when you have surplus cash, you will go for marketable securities. When you have deficit cash, you will sell them and get the money. So these assets keep changing their shape and type. Then current liabilities, the payments we have to make to the outside world, that is the from the suppliers of the inventories, we may buy material on the credit. So maybe after the due period, we have to pay them the money. Then only they will be able to supply to us again and again, and without losing all the reputation. So at what time we have to keep the money in what form? That is important. So as I told you, if you have surplus money, surplus cash, it is not creating you any money. If you are putting your money into a, suppose, current account, it is not going to give you any return. So if you think you have, if you think that you don't require cash, say for say 15 days or a month, then just keeping it in the current account is not a wise decision from the point of view of the business. So what you have to do is, you have to go for short term securities. You may buy them, so which may yield little bit interest and revenue to the company. So managing these, each component of the current asset is also very important. Similarly, if you keep a huge pile up of inventories without yielding any return, is also a big loss. You have if you have purchased stocks which is required for the entire year, and if you have purchased them and just kept them in the godown, it is not only loss for loss of interest in the capital. You have to spend extra on maintaining those inventories without overseeing them, without for their quality also. Because sometimes when you keep the material for a long period, there is a chance of not only pilferage but get spoiled. So all this, you have to carrying cost, what we call them as, if you keep the inventory for a long period, the cost of carrying those inventories also will be additional burden on the company. not only you are blocking the capital, in addition you are also incurring extra cost. So it is not sensible when you can go to market immediately and get some kind of material, then there is no point in just carrying them for a year and trying to buy them at a time and carrying them for a particular year. That makes no sense. So each of these decisions is very important and is going to affect your profitability. So as a finance manager, you have to be careful about each of these decisions. For example, if the market is market forever this thing also, for example your products, if the market for products is not very encouraging, just producing them and keeping it also is not a wise decision. So you have to decide either to make more marketing efforts and sell them in the market, or reduce your production levels so that idle stocks won't be piled up and unnecessarily it won't affect your profitability. So intermixing and interchange of these current assets is a very careful decision, and you have to be constantly monitoring them. And whenever required, if the cash is not there, it is going to create a bad reputation in the company, and further you may not be able to get credit from the market, so that ultimately it may affect your production schedule also. Next, what is happening is to trade off between the profitability. Yeah, ultimately, that is what I explained you. If you have excess cash is going to give you liquidity, but it is not giving you any profit. So what you have to do is you have to engage your excess cash in profitable manner without affecting your liquidity. So when you require the money, you should be able to get that money back. So that is the where the marketable securities come into the help, and people can think of investing those things in the marketable securities, which will give you some additional revenue to the company. So optimal mix of all these decisions are very important, rather it is essential, then only your profitability of the company is going to increase. Then we come to the second important decision of the financial management, that is financing decision. As I told you, there are two ways of financing a particular asset, maybe by raising debt. There are various sources from where we can raise debt, and then of course equity. There is a spending mistake. It is equity, not equality. So equity is your own money. Equity has certain advantages because we need not pay any return to the equity holders. If you are in a problem or if you are in the initial years, you may not have profits, so you need not pay the equity holders. It is not binding on the company. But if you have gone for a debt capital, there is a requirement for them. You have to pay them interest. So depending upon level of your profitability, you can decide what form and to what extent we can use these debt and finance options in order to finance a particular asset. So ideal mix of these two sources is the is going to yield a better profit to the corporation. If you go for a debt capital, sometimes what happens is there may be a pressure from the debt providers, that and it may create sometimes risk also, because if you are not able to pay their obligations, it is a problem. So the combination or the proportion of debt and equity depends on the risk and return levels of the company also. Because if the company is able to generate profits, then it is all right. We can use debt, we can pay them interest, then still there may be a say margin which will again be contributed to the increase of the profit, increasing profitability of the shareholders. Sometimes if your cost of if your rate of return is not adequate, so meeting the cost of the debt, it is always better we go for equity share, equity capital, and put them safely in the business without creating problems for the business. So it all depends how much you are able to generate by putting that money from the project. Then comes the dividend decision. As I told you, there are practices, there are different forms in which dividend can be paid, that you can read it from the unit which is given the material. The important point here is whether to pay the entire profits in the form of dividends or to retain a portion and reinvest it in the business. Because if the company has more revenues to generate more profits, it is always better to retain a particular portion of the money and generate higher rate of return and pay them higher returns to the shareholders. Particularly this is more important because if the shareholders are not able to get more revenues or profitable revenues than the company has, it is more important and the company should think of keeping the money with them and reinvesting them and paying them higher returns. And again, there may be a situation where company may not be able to raise capital so easily. So in such situations also, it is better to keep a particular portion of the profits and use it for the future expansion and development of the company. Sometimes there are various factors, so I am not giving you all the factors which will decide the dividend decisions, because
meanwhile if you have any questions, we would like to take up the questions now.
Because these are given in the unit also. Sometimes you may have more shareholders which are in a particular category. Suppose say retired persons. If your shareholders are more retired persons or senior citizens who need regular kind of income, so you need to have a more policy of paying regular dividends so that they can meet their personal obligations and returns. So like that, these factors, many factors are there. These factors are going to decide what kind of policy you should follow towards your dividends. Yeah. Are there any questions at this point of time?
If you have any question, we would like to take up the questions now.
Let us hope somebody is hearing us. Yeah, then the risk and return trade-off, this is very important, because it is always, if you take higher risk, there is a chance of getting higher returns. If you are not very risk aware, if you are not very risk taking, then your returns are also very less. It is very simple, if you see, we have a different investment opportunities as individuals. Let us talk first as individuals. We have different kinds of investment avenues. If you have a surplus money, you have a range of investment options, from fixed deposits to share market. So the level or the option you are going to choose will decide, is depending upon the risk you are ready to take. So, depending upon your, the risk, your risk-taking ability, your return is going to be decided. For example, if you are not able to take, if you are not interested in taking any risk at all, so you are risk-averse, what you do normally, go to a scheduled nationalized bank and put your money in the fixed deposit. So, very safe, but you get a very kind of reasonable, not very, very high level of return. Suppose if you are ready to take risk, what you do, you put your money in the, say, stock market, and there also there are two approaches. One may do day trading or try to make money by selling and purchasing very frequently, and another approach is you buy, make investments and wait for some long term, a little longish period, and get a reasonable return. So if you are doing, say, day trading or very selling them frequently and buying them frequently, so the return may be higher. At the same time, there is also very high risk. The purchase price of your share may go up or may go come down. So if you have borrowed the money and invested the money in the market, what happens is you cannot hold those securities, so you have to sell them at any cost, because otherwise you have to pay the interest. So you are, there is a chance of incurring huge loss. That is why the risk of the decision and return of the decision are very closely related, and they go in tandem. So the higher the risk, the higher the return. The lower the risk, the lower the return. Financial decisions of a firm are guided by risk and return, this risk and return trade-off, the ability to take risk and the expectation of the return. These two are going to decide your financial decisions. If you put this particular thing in a equation, return is equal to risk-free rate of return, risk-free rate plus risk premium. That means what the return you are going to get is the risk-free rate. So if you are putting the money in the fixed deposit, that is the risk-free rate. So you will get only that much. If you are ready to take little more risk, so you need premium for that, for taking that risk. So the combination of risk-free return and risk premium will make your return, the rate of return you are expecting. So risk-free return is a compensation. Why, what is that, why do we get risk-free return? Because you are postponing your needs and investing them in a particular asset. So you need to get some return for that, and maybe sometimes even for the inflationary factors also, that both your postponement of your requirements and the effect of the inflation, both should reflect in your rate of return. Then only it is real reflection of the return, otherwise it is otherwise you are losing value of your investment. So to simply summarize the whole discussion so far, what is happening in this see this chart. Financial management is the topic. What is that we are trying to do through financial management? Maximize the share value. For maximizing the share value, you need to take some financial decisions. What are those financial decisions? Investment decisions. That is, investing them in long-term assets, how much and what to invest. Then liquidity, liquidity durations means short term durations. Then financing, how to finance these assets, then dividend durations, and all these durations involve the ability of the risk you take and the return you are going to get from these durations. So to summarize the whole financial management, these are the important three decisions. Of course, investment decision involves two: capital decision, capital budgeting decision, and liquidity decision. So this is the entire spectrum of the financial management, basic financial management. So what we try to do in the course also, I will come back to these slides slightly later. What we try to do in this course also.
We may have the slide, please.
So what we try to do in the course also is financial analysis, financial and investment analysis. This is the first unit we try to give you. Through in the second unit, 12th unit, we try to give you the ratio analysis. Through the ratios and leverage analysis, you are able to calculate the ratios and interpret the decisions. Then budgeting and budgetary control. Then investment appraisal method. This is also called capital budgeting. So these are the three decisions. What we are doing is, in the first level, in the basic level, we have devoted some three units here. But if you take the finance specialization, what is going to happen is, this unit 16 is a complete course, that is management of working capital, or we can say working capital management. And then unit 17, that is capital structure, we call the course as, this is another course which is we call it as capital investment and financing decisions, because the how you invest the capital and how from where you finance those capital, that is that capital, that is important. So these two units are in the specialization level, they are independent courses. So the dividend decisions, of course, we have tried to cover it in this particular course itself. So what I am trying to say is, these three decisions are the entire spectrum of financial management. There are other courses which are not directly related with these things, but which may help in the process of managing the company. Suppose we have a course on management of management control systems. That, of course, that comes in the budgeting and budgetary control, but we have done it more elaborately. Well, that will help you as a tool to have better management, financial management. Similarly, we have securities analysis and portfolio management, which will teach you how to invest the money, and particularly in the securities market and portfolios and those things. Then we have a course on investment, international financial management, which will teach you, if you are in the international business, which you are, if your business is in the international scene also, that particular course will tell you whether to raise funds from international sources advisable or not. So like that, the core of financial management is this.
Sir, I think we don't have time now, so on behalf of all the students, I would like to thank you for giving such a good insight into the financial management and the various decisions that are taken in financing. Thank you.
Thank you.